Hello, everyone, and welcome to Advising for Future Ready Careers. My name is Kelsey Kamen, and I'm the program coordinator for NCWIT Counselors for Computing. It's my pleasure to bring you the fifth episode of this six-part series hosted by NCWIT C4C. Each month through July, we will be connecting you with thought leaders at the cutting edge of technology. This series offers a unique opportunity to dive into the intersection of computer science with traditional and non-traditional STEM fields, also known as C+X. Throughout the presentation, we would love for you to submit questions through the Q&A feature at the bottom of the toolbar. We will also be sharing resources in the chat feature, also found at the bottom of the toolbar at the bottom of your screen. The National Center for Women in Information Technology, or NCWIT, is a nonprofit community of more than 1,400 universities, companies, nonprofits, and government organizations nationwide. NCWIT equips change leaders with resources for taking action in recruiting, retaining, and advancing women across the entire computing ecosystem. Before NCWIT, programs focusing on women in computing existed mostly in isolation, without the benefit of shared practices, effective resources, communication with others, or national reach. Today, these programs are part of the NCWIT community, creating a far greater impact than if institutions acted alone. Counselors for Computing, or C4C, is one of the programs in the NCWIT K-12 Alliance. And the NCWIT Counselors for Computing program provides information and resources that help counselors join the front line of the computing conversation. We bring people and programs together with professional development, knowledge, and resources to give all students access to transformative computing careers. And we wouldn't be here today without the support of our sponsor, the Department of Defense STEM, the largest employer of scientists and engineers in the nation. DoD STEM offers educational programs, internships, and scholarships for students and many career development opportunities for educators. We shared their website in the chat for you to learn more. I would now like to present to you Jess Smith. She's currently a research intern for FATE at Microsoft Research. FATE stands for Fairness, Accountability, Transparency, and Ethics in AI. She's also a PhD student at the University of Colorado Boulder, researching machine learning and AI ethics with an emphasis on algorithmic fairness, transparency, and education. Her PhD research currently focuses on multi-stakeholder recommender systems, where ethics constraints like fairness and transparency are often in tension between stakeholders. Jess's work also focuses on double-sided education, teaching computer scientists about ethics and educating users to improve their algorithmic literacy. More information can be found on her website, which can be found in the chat. Thank you so much, Jess. And please enjoy this presentation by Jess Smith on ethics and computing.
Hi, everyone. My name is Jessie J. Smith, but feel free to call me Jess or Jessie. I'm a PhD student studying AI, machine learning, and broadly, computer science ethics. And today, I'm going to be talking to you all about this field. What is it? How did it emerge? How did I become a computer science ethicist? How can other people join? And why does this discipline matter? So we've all heard the buzzwords before. Artificial intelligence, or AI, machine learning, or ML, big data, the cloud, the fourth industrial revolution, Skynet, Terminator. The media has shipped and sold us visions of what our technological future might look like. Some are utopias, like Meet the Robinsons or the Jetsons, though most depictions of our future are quite the opposite. Dystopic images of robots taking over the world and AI becoming the singularity that wipes out all of humankind. But fortunately, I work in the field of computer science ethics, and part of my job is to try to make sure that our future looks a little bit less like this and a little bit more like this. So you might be wondering, how did I get here? What led me to pursue a career in computer science ethics? And let's just begin at the beginning. I originally grew up on the Chesapeake Bay in Maryland with two older brothers and a cat. Here I spent lots of time playing in the mud and hardly ever any time in front of a screen or a computer. I was never expecting to go into the field of computer science. As a kid, I actually had dreams of becoming an astronomer or maybe a professional singer or an athlete. As I grew a little bit older, I began to have dreams of being this social justice warrior. I wanted to save the world with my job. I just didn't quite know what my job would be yet, and I didn't quite know how to save the world yet. But I did know that I wanted to make a positive impact on the world, at the very least. When it came to computers, though, I wasn't necessarily the most digitally literate. The computer person in my family was actually my oldest brother, Wesley. And yes, this is actually a picture of Wesley with the original Game Boy color. And Wesley was your stereotypical computer scientist, self-taught by middle school, already building his own computers at home, and opting to spend the weekends locked away in his room inventing new things with code. I, however, was not like this. Whatever time I spent in front of the computer was either to watch Disney Channel shows or to make my own videos and post them on an up-and-coming website that I had just heard of called YouTube. You might have heard of it before too. So although I wasn't the most tech-savvy person growing up, I was coming of age right around a time when technology and computers were becoming a part of everyday life. At this point, I was living in a small mountain town in Utah. I joined social media in high school, and I got a smartphone shortly after. My high school was also part of this new program that gave us all laptops during my senior year to do work on and also to take to our classes with us. I still had no idea how to code, though, and I had no idea how computers worked at all, but I did interface with computers pretty regularly, and that was enough for my older brother to eventually encourage me to see what it was like to code. It wasn't actually until my junior year of high school that I started thinking more seriously about what I wanted my career to be. I had visions of being a high school music teacher, actually, or maybe even a psychologist, though at the time I had no idea what that meant. And I had one more year in high school with one extra elective in my course load that I could take. So I decided to try to fill that final elective with whichever class would prepare me best for the career that I was hoping to pursue. And at this point in time, my high school had decided to add one particular advanced AP course for the first time ever, advanced AP computer science. So at this point in time, I spoke with my brother and I told him that I was deciding which class to enroll in that was best to set me up for my career. But I told him that computer science scared me. I said things like, "Isn't coding for boys?" Or, "I've never tried computer science before. What if I'm not good enough?" I came at him with every excuse I had, and luckily for me, it wasn't enough. Wesley was stubborn, and he eventually convinced me to sign up for the class. So I enrolled, and during my senior year of high school, I experienced coding for the first time ever, and I hated it. I was not a fan of computer science when I first learned how to code. I felt like I was learning slower than anyone else in the class, and I was incredibly intimidated by the people who had been teaching themselves already for years, kind of like my brother. But fortunately, I also like challenges. So when college application season rolled around in my senior year of high school, even though I was really dreading this AP computer science class that I was taking, I decided to apply to college to pursue a degree in computer science anyway. I ended up attending California Polytechnic State University, which is otherwise known as Cal Poly, for a degree in software engineering. And software engineering is basically the same as computer science, though you end up taking a little bit more math, but you also get more opportunities to work with teams on projects in a format that you would typically encounter at a large tech company nowadays. The first 2 years of my degree, I'm going to be honest, were hard. And there were quite a few times where I wasn't sure if I would actually be able to make it all 4 years. I was one of very few women in classes, sometimes the only woman in a class, the only woman in a class filled with brilliant men who knew computers like they knew the back of their hands. I was intimidated and constantly fueled by imposter syndrome. But around my third year of college, I eventually made friends with those in my classes. And instead of being intimidated by the knowledgeable people in classes, I started to learn from them. And before I knew it, I was comfortably on my way to becoming a full-time software developer for a large tech company. Things were really looking up. but something just didn't feel quite right. So it was at this point in time that I was in the spring semester of my third year of college, and the most serendipitous combination of classes opened my eyes to a whole new future. During this semester, I signed up to take my very first data science class ever. The idea of machine learning had always fascinated me, and data science seemed to be the way to tap into that field. During the semester, I was also required to take what was called our professional responsibilities course, which was actually the single required ethics course for computer scientists at my university. So during this spring semester, in the mornings, I would attend my data science class, and in the afternoons, I would attend my computer ethics class. Then on one rainy spring day, I feel like I can remember this day like it was yesterday, I walked into my data science class in the morning, and we spent a few hours learning how to build formulas and functions that allowed us to scrape the web and pull data off of any website that we wanted, even if we didn't have permission to access that data. And later in the same day, I went to my computer ethics class, and we spent an entire lecture talking about privacy and how scraping data off of the web without permission is an unethical act. So it was at that point in time when I had what I call my aha moment. In a single day, I was being given the power and knowledge to build things like web scrapers, machine learning predictors, artificially intelligent algorithms, while simultaneously in a different class, I was learning how and why those kinds of technologies can be dangerous and harmful to society. Now, before I finish my story, I want to briefly interject at this point, because you might be wondering, but how specifically can technology be harmful to society? Why is computer science ethics actually important? Well, I have quite a bit to say about this. So you might have noticed over the last decade that the headlines in the news have increasingly begun to include scandals that continue to happen within the tech industry. There's stories about rogue algorithms and black box machines that are wreaking havoc on society and causing harm to mostly vulnerable communities. And these tech scandals are all examples of what can happen when ethics is excluded from the discipline of computer science. And whether or not we realize it, we've all been the victim of unethical computer science at one point or another. So now I'm going to outline for all of you 6 different examples of unethical tech. And this is 6 of many, I should say. It was just the first 6 that came to my head. And in these examples, these have all caused harm in some form or another. Though keep in mind that in some of these scenarios, much more harm was caused than in others. So I will start us off with a gentle example. This is something that probably all of us have encountered before, something called the infinite scroll. In the early 2010s, you might have realized that scrolling through websites or apps, particularly social media apps, became quite a bit easier because of a new feature called the infinite scroll. This feature was branded as something that allowed users to, quote, enjoy frictionless browsing. However, as you might be aware of, there were some unfortunate side effects to this feature. And whether or not the designers and computer scientists who made this feature were aware of this at the time, one of the biggest side effects of the feature was that without a natural stopping point on a timeline or a discover page, there was no indication when a user should stop scrolling, hence the name the infinite scroll. So over the past decade, this feature has been widely ridiculed as a contributor to what is called addictive design, which basically just means that this design, intentionally or not, has contributed to humans becoming more addicted to our devices. And just like most other features that we encounter on our devices, the infinite scroll was created by a well-meaning computer scientist, someone named Asa Raskin. And ironically, actually, after unleashing the infinite scroll on society and social media, Asa, the person who created this, realized the negative effects that this feature had on society and actually ended up devoting his career to computer science ethics and creating humane technology instead. But another example of addictive design is a feature that we've probably all also encountered in some way as well, something called autoplay. And this is on platforms like Netflix, Hulu, or YouTube. So before autoplay was initially introduced, when we watched videos online, you might remember that we had to manually click a button to take us to the next thing that we wanted to watch. This gave us the time and opportunity to make a decision to stop watching, especially if we'd already been watching something for quite a long time. However, now with an autoplay feature, we have to try to rush to our device to stop the next thing from playing before we get wrapped into yet another episode of our latest binge-worthy, as Netflix calls it, TV show. And this kind of addictive technology is considered unethical by many scholars because it causes adverse effects to users. So addictive design does not contribute to human welfare. It does not contribute to human health. It actually often deteriorates it instead. And the incentives for using this kind of technology are generally to try to keep users on the platform for as long as possible, which is generally used for monetary reasons rather than to holistically benefit users and their needs. The next example of unethical technology is also something that most of us have likely experienced before, whether or not we've realized it. And if you've ever tried to search for information or the answer to a question at some point in the last decade or two, you have likely pulled up a Google search page. But have you ever tried searching for something on Google at the same time as someone else and compared the results? You might be surprised to find out that your results could differ widely from the person sitting right next to you, depending on your socioeconomic status, your race, your age, and your geographical location in the world. This is because even though Google search is often thought of as a neutral entity, it's actually using what's called a personalized algorithm, which basically just means that the results that you get from a Google search are catered to what Google thinks is the most relevant results for you, whether or not they actually are. So I first noticed this personalization feature when I was searching for flights on Google using their flight searching website. And my older brother, Wesley, pictured here, much older than the other pictures, and this is who I've mentioned before, he was sitting right next to me searching for the same flight that I was searching for. Now, Wesley's a full-time software developer, and I'm a graduate student, which means that he makes a little bit more money in his paycheck than I do, and Google was aware of this. So the results for the flights that we searched for showed up exactly the same on both of our screens, on both of our devices, with one exception. Wesley's flights were a bit more expensive than mine were, about $80 more expensive. So we both tried searching for the flights in incognito mode instead, and we realized that the price of the flights matched when our personal information was taken out of the equation. So basically, Google discovered that my brother made more money than the average person searching for flights, so they decided to raise the price of his flights to be above average, with the assumption that he could pay for a flight that was priced above average. This is something that I would have never been aware of, despite the fact that this is my field of research, if I hadn't seen it right before my own eyes on my brother's screen. And this is also something that is not ever publicly shared with Google users. And in general, personalization as a Google search feature is not something that's commonly shared with Google search users either. And personalization on Google search can be really harmful when we're unaware that it's happening. In some countries, the first news results to show up on Google are based out of the USA instead of based out of the local country that the person is searching from because of these personalization algorithms. And sometimes this can unintentionally perpetuate colonizer narratives in those countries. So Google search personalization is basically the equivalent of someone entering a library and being directed to only one specific small section of that library without having any knowledge that there are hundreds of floors above and below them, each filled with information that might be more relevant to them than the original section that they were directed to. And like in all the other scenarios I've mentioned so far, this feature was also thought up and created by a computer scientist. All right, next case study. So one of the most heavily cited tech scandals that's occurred in the last decade was one that was discovered by an organization called ProPublica. And this is when they audited an algorithm that was made by an organization called Northpoint. The algorithm was called the infamous Compass algorithm, and it was being used by the police department in Broward County, Florida, to predict what is called recidivism risk, or the likelihood that someone will recommit a crime after they've been convicted. So basically, the algorithm worked like this. When someone was arrested for a crime, they would fill out a questionnaire with at least 70 questions. It would ask them things about their past, their family's past, their day-to-day lives, and then the answer to these questions would be fed into an algorithm that had access to a bunch of historical crime data. The algorithm would then spit out a score between 1 and 10. A score of 1 meant that this person had a low likelihood of committing another crime. A score of 10 meant that this person had a high likelihood of committing another crime. And these scores were often given to judges and juries and used as evidence or justification to allow a defendant to be let out on bail or parole. And sometimes it even influenced the final sentencing that a defendant got. Unfortunately, the designers of this algorithm were not computer science ethicists, and they didn't think through all of the unintended consequences of unleashing an algorithm like this out into police departments. So when ProPublica decided to audit the algorithm, they discovered that its use of historical crime data to determine risk scores was largely biased to favor white people. Given the history of racism and discrimination in our criminal system in the USA. And this history of US racism was encoded into the data that was used to fuel the Compass algorithm. So in turn, this algorithm unintentionally gave higher risk scores to anyone who wasn't white. The algorithm was producing unfair, inaccurate, and racist results because no one had thought about this unintended consequence when they wrote the code to create it. So now, had a computer ethicist been working on this algorithm, they might have caught this issue before it was given to the police, or they might have realized that this technology should not be given to the police or deployed at all. And Compass isn't the only algorithm that's been given to police departments or governing bodies. So this is our next case study. Another infamous case study about unethical uses of technology is the case of facial recognition and facial classification software. Two different things though. So the way that facial recognition software works is that an algorithm is fed in a bunch of pictures of human faces. And just like how humans learn, over time, the algorithm slowly becomes more able to identify the features and the qualities of a human face. This is how we're able to do things like unlocking our phones or our computers with our faces, because the computer is able to recognize the specific patterns of our unique facial features, and then the computer uses that recognition as a password to open our device, or rather the algorithm does. And this is how filters on apps like Snapchat or Instagram work as well. The algorithm identifies where our face is and then maps on things like bunny ears or funny images to correctly align with our face. However, this software is far from perfect, especially since it often produces more accurate results for lighter skinned faces than for darker skinned faces. And some incredible scholars discovered this discrepancy back in 2017 and wrote a famous paper about it. One of the scholars who was an author on this paper was Joy Bwalamwini, who's pictured here, and she's actually the founder of the Algorithmic Justice League, which I'll talk about in a little bit. So one major reason why this discrepancy happens in facial recognition software is because the data that is used to create these AI algorithms often has many more examples of light-skinned faces than of dark-skinned faces to learn from. And unfortunately, since the majority of these computer scientists who were working on these algorithms at the time had lighter skin, this problem actually went unnoticed and unchallenged for quite a long time. And even worse, facial recognition has actually played a harmful role in quite a few people's lives ever since this technology was sold to police departments around the world. In one scenario just last year, a Black man named Robert Julian Borchuk Williams was arrested for a crime that he did not commit because the facial recognition software that the police were using had incorrectly identified him. This was largely due to the problems that I just described. And another example of a tech scandal, we have this one and one more. Another example happened just across the pond over in the United Kingdom just last summer. So every summer, hundreds of thousands of British students sit for what are called the advanced level qualification exams, also known as the A-level exams. And this helps the schools determine which students can go to which universities. The results of this test are really important for the futures of these students because a low score can make students ineligible for the college programs that they were hoping to enroll in. It's kind of like the ACT or the SAT. But due to COVID, in the summer of 2020, the British government decided to cancel the in-person test, and they instead developed an algorithm that would predict which scores the students would have gotten, taking into account estimates from teachers, grade histories, and other factors. After the algorithm was deployed, it was discovered to be very unfair and very inaccurate, and was actually ridiculed for perpetuating the social and economic inequality that's been built into the UK's schooling system. Ultimately, fortunately, the government decided to abandon the results of the algorithm and stick with the teachers' initial estimates. But this fiasco has now turned into an infamous case study for how AI algorithms can wreak havoc when they're deployed in an inappropriate context. Okay, on to our last case study. My final example of unethical tech today does not end in addictive scrolling or misclassification or undeserved sentencing, but it does end in death. In 2017, the first recorded self-driving car death occurred from a newly deployed self-driven Uber vehicle in Tempe, Arizona. It was late at night, and the woman who was in the vehicle had quite a bit of trust in the self-driving car. She had so much trust, in fact, that she was watching the TV show The Voice on her phone as the self-driving car drove her to her destination. Unfortunately, another person happened to be crossing the street right as this car approached. The woman operating the vehicle was too distracted to brake in time, and the pedestrian crossing the street was unfortunately hit and killed. And in the investigation that occurred after this incident, it was concluded that Uber's self-driving car system could not correctly classify and predict the path of a pedestrian crossing mid-block. And this self-driving car scenario is infamous in the field of computer ethics because of the inherent trade-offs that must be made in the event of an unavoidable collision when it comes to self-driving cars. It's basically a new version of the trolley problem, if you've heard of this before. So for example, if a self-driving car finds itself in a situation where it either has to hit several pedestrians or risk injuring the driver, and those are the only two options, what decision should the car make? And this is a decision that a computer scientist can encode into the car if they want. This question has gone unanswered for a long time, and self-driving car companies have largely been avoiding it so that they don't have to face accountability if a scenario like this does occur. So, hopefully this gives you all a better picture of what unethical technology looks like, whether it's in feature design or algorithm development or data curation or technology deployment. It's cases like all of these that have led to a more global urge for computer science ethics. And unfortunately, all of these examples seemingly paint a similar grim story for us. Computing technology has now entered every facet of our lives. Our education, our healthcare, policing, Congress, our work, our entertainment, our communication with loved ones. And this technology lives in our pockets, in our backpacks, in our hands, every single day. And even scarier, there's no governing body that looks over all of these technologies. There are no computer science police that ensure that every technology that's created is done with human welfare in mind. There are no laws that attempt to govern big tech. But the field is moving too quickly for legal bodies to keep up and in order for them to anticipate the potential unintended harmful consequences that occur from new technologies every day. Now that you are all a bit familiar with unethical tech and why computer science ethics is so important, I'll get back to my story. So it was in my third year of college, on that rainy spring day, when I was lucky that I was enrolled in this computer ethics class while taking my first data science course. I was lucky that I was able to ask why I should create a technology instead of just asking how to create it. I started to question why I hadn't learned about these kinds of harms in my coding classes. When I was learning how to write algorithms, why wasn't I learning about the harms of designing technologies? When I was learning how to use big data, why wasn't I learning about the ways in which categorization can reduce humans to a number? I began to realize that all over the world at that moment, there were probably tens of thousands of students learning computer science for the first time without any formal training in ethics or ethical decision-making either. So it was on that rainy spring day in California when I figured out for the first time what I actually wanted to do with my career. I wanted to be a computer science ethicist. And more specifically, I wanted to be a machine learning and AI ethicist. I wanted to help teach others to do the same. Luckily, what I didn't realize at the time was that I was joining a quickly emerging discipline that was full of incredible people and opportunities. The field of computer science ethics. So it was at this point that I decided to become an expert in AI ethics. Luckily, right around this time, one of my good friends in college was applying to attend grad school as a PhD student. At the time, I didn't even know what getting a PhD meant, and I had absolutely no idea that you could get paid for it. So I started looking into programs that had some sort of focus on tech ethics, and I landed at the University of Colorado Boulder, where I researched all the things that I've laid out in front of you today: computer science, ethics, machine learning, and how to build a better world with technology while mitigating the harms that technology can cause. Right now, I'm interning for a research lab based out of Microsoft on a team called FATE, which stands for Fairness, Accountability, Transparency, and Ethics in AI. This was a team that I had actually first heard of during my third year in my undergraduate degree. It was a team that was full of incredible researchers that I only dreamt I could one day meet, let alone work together with. Last year, I also co-founded a podcast that I now host called the Radical AI Podcast. And there we discuss a lot of the tech ethics scandals that I've laid out before you earlier in this talk. I get to spend my free time talking to people about what's wrong with technology and how there are teams of brilliant and passionate minds working together to solve these problems. I also teach computer science ethics to undergraduate students, but instead of teaching a one-off class that tries to catch computer scientists before they graduate, I teach introductory courses with freshman students who are just learning to code. And I teach about topics like ethical decision-making, how to design technologies with human values in mind, and how to spot when code can cause unintended harm to others. The good thing is, computer science ethics isn't just for PhD students. This discipline is growing rapidly, and it needs more passionate individuals to join in on the conversation. There are dozens of information schools and computer science departments and labs at universities that are beginning to think about these kinds of issues. And more groups of people are joining in on the fight for more ethical tech every single day. There are nonprofits and organizations like the Algorithmic Justice League, which I mentioned before, that was founded by Joy Bualamwini, or organizations like Stop LAPD Spying to help solve some of the problems with facial recognition and classification, or student-led coalitions like the YX Foundation or Encode Justice, which is a youth-led organization fighting for human rights and equity in the age of artificial intelligence. Large tech companies like Microsoft, Mozilla, Facebook, Verizon, Uber, and TikTok are also starting to hire computer science ethicists and what they call trust and safety engineers to work on problems about fairness and bias and a lot of the things that I've laid out today and issues with algorithms. Computer science departments are also starting to think more critically about the ethical implications of technology, and they're looking for more people to help in this fight. Social science and philosophy departments are starting to focus more on technology, and they're contributing to the conversation in ways that they never could have before. And one of my absolute favorite things about this field of computer science ethics is that the discipline is largely interdisciplinary. This means that you don't have to be a master coder to participate, which I would, you know, high school me would have loved to hear at the time. Most of the work that I do every day is actually away from code and a little bit removed from code, and instead is in front of people. For some of my research, I ask people how technology has harmed them and how they might envision it being better. Social scientists, statisticians, philosophers, digital archivers, ethnographers, journalists, humanitarians, and computer scientists alike are all starting to come together to tackle some of these difficult problems. And together, they are paving the field of computer science ethics. And the good news is that many of these labs, groups, scholars, and organizations cater to university students, graduate students, and even K through 12 students. And they're looking for more passionate people to join the cause. It's never too early to start to pursue a career in computer science ethics. And there are more and more career opportunities opening up every passing day. So if there's anything that I want you to take away from this talk today, it's this. The technological reality that we exist in right now has a lot of room for improvement. Things aren't perfect. Sometimes things are really bad, but we don't have to accept this as our future. Anyone who is passionate about making a positive impact on the world is well-equipped to work as a computer science ethicist. Children, teenagers, young adults, people in their second careers, retired folks, anyone can join this movement. Together, we can all work with one another to envision the positive technological future that we hope to live in. And with some patience and hard work, we can make that positive future our reality. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jess. We have quite an active Q&A. So let's just start off with like some of these ethical questions. I get the first one is with high school students and teaching starting to bring in those robotics courses, those computing courses, where would you say to start to bring in those ethical considerations? Where should teachers start? What curriculum changes should be made?
Definitely. Yeah. So also in that question, I think they asked if I had ethics included in my AP computer science class, and like most definitely not. I don't think that ethics was even a part of the conversation back then. But I will say that for especially for K through 12, I think that it's important to approach these topics in an accessible way. And so I don't think that you should be having people like K through 12 students reading like Plato and Aristotle and ethics, like all these giant white texts of ethics. I think that the best place that I've experienced as teaching younger students to start is places that are close to home. So if you want to inform students about some of the harms of a recommender system, then ask them what kinds of apps they use and what kinds of websites they visit, and then talk about maybe like addictive design, for example, is a really good starting point, because most people use video streaming platforms. Or, you know, you don't have to start with like the trolley problem because it's so theoretical. There's so many ethical concerns and considerations and things that are happening just in our hands and on our own devices every day that we can use case studies from the things that we experience every day. And so that my first piece of advice would be to use realistic real world scenarios that the students are interacting with. And my second piece of advice would be, if you're thinking of specific topics that are important to teach, then make sure that you're not telling students, this is what's wrong, this is what's right, because everybody has their own subjective experience of what is wrong and right. And also that might make parents angry. So instead, what works better in my experience is teaching students how to ethically make decisions on their own values and their own terms. And so they recognize that making decisions in code and in computer science, it is embedded in values. And so they need to understand that their decisions will make an impact on people. And so it's up to them to decide what's going to be wrong or right.
So it's almost like, as educators, often our mission is to cultivate critical thinkers. We might want to add in that we want to cultivate ethical critical thinkers. I think about like some of our like reading. I was thinking like when I was in high school, we had to read Anthem by Ayn Rand, which would not be I think great required reading these days, but if they were to have brought in ethical considerations that bring in the technology currently, that might be something that more of a language that students would speak. So I like how you said bringing it into the classroom, kind of just having students start thinking about their decision making. I really like that. So on top of that, if we gear away from students, how do we kind of convince our colleagues that maybe software they're using isn't ethical, or maybe even teaching practices?
Yeah, definitely. This is something that I've struggled with a bit. It's been kind of a challenge in some of the work that I've done trying to convince computer science educators to incorporate ethics in the classroom, because it's hard to make time for things that aren't technical in a classroom that's already packing so much stuff into just a very short period of time. And so that's why I advocate a lot for, in the classroom at least, making sure that you're not thinking of ethics as this like one-off module that needs to be taught over the course of a week, but you can actually integrate ethics into all of your class discussions and all of your assignments. And it actually tends to make the assignments more interesting for the students anyway. Like when I was learning computer science at the very beginning of my degree, I think there were three different classes where I had to make some sort of like grocery list, to-do list application. And instead of making a grocery list, if we had made, a list that had to do with like videos that you might find on TikTok on your phone, or if we had made, some version of like the trolley problem, like a list of the kinds of people that get to be saved in a car accident from a self-driving car. There's like ways that you can make the assignments that students do, even at the beginner level, really interesting and fascinating, that get students thinking about ethical decision-making. And it doesn't have to be at the sacrifice of the technical content. And that actually, I think one of the links that was shared here is an introductory Python course that I came up with a bunch of modules for. And those are examples of assignments that are really simple beginner computer science assignments that could be given to high schoolers that have like these interesting real world ethical decision making scenarios. So I think I answered half of your question. And the first half of your question was...
Well, I think you did answer the question as far as like getting colleagues to buy in. I mean, it's an issue that we all, like any of us have when we're working with a group of people. And it's just trying to, like kind of how you said, bringing in almost like a thought experiment to a faculty and staff meeting. So maybe trying to get them to think differently and just by bringing these resources. Can you repeat which resource it was that you said was great for bringing into high school students?
Yes. Yeah, that is, I think Maureen just shared it in the chat. It's just a Google Drive link right now. Eventually I'm going to make a GitHub repo with it, but you'll have to reach out to me directly if you want the solutions, because we use it at my university. And so we're trying to not give the answers away to students. But also just like a quick thought about convincing colleagues that this stuff is important and that these topics matter. I encourage everyone to kind of just reflect on how they feel after using technology and after using certain apps. And for me, I know like after I use an app like TikTok, I feel kind of like exhausted after. I feel like it sort of drained my energy because of that infinite scroll. Or like after I sit down at a dinner and everybody's on their phones and interacting with their technology instead of each other because of design choices for that technology, that doesn't feel great either. And I know that whenever I discover that my data was given to a bunch of third parties off of social media sites that I never wanted to give it to advertisers for, that also doesn't feel great too. So like trying to have these kinds of conversations with people and asking them the ways in which technology harms them implicitly without them maybe realizing, and instead of being like slaves to our devices, basically taking that ownership and that agency and recognizing that we don't have to be controlled by the devices that we use every day, we can actually have a healthy relationship with the technology that is a part of like every second of our lives almost.
I really like that suggestion, because a lot of our attendees are school counselors. So it's like turning to them and saying, well, how does this make you feel? And so, which is a question we actually try to avoid, but it is something to maybe get other individuals or colleagues that aren't really buying in to start noticing exactly what you're saying, that fatigue or that general poor feeling after they've interacted with a piece of technology. I also want to let everyone know, we shared quite a few resources in the chat. You are able to copy those and maybe paste them into a Google Doc or a Word document. So that way you're able to keep all of those and look at them, because it is robust, the amount of resources that we've shared, but super helpful to start bringing into your classrooms or share with your students or even your kids. Okay, I'm gonna put two questions together, because we had one question about the trolley issue or trolley experiment issue, and whether or not it's legal, but then another question about whether or not there are a code of ethics of some kind for computer scientists. And I know that with most career fields, there's the legalities and the regulations that we have to follow, and then there's the ethical considerations. So what is available? What is the overlap of legal versus ethical?
Oh, wow. Yeah, that's, I mean, it's hard to answer, because there's simultaneously too many ethical resources for how to be ethical in tech and no resources for how to actually make it happen. And there's not really a whole lot of accountability either. So unfortunately, most of the biggest ethical frameworks and guidelines that have been published are not actually used as a way for computer scientists to be more ethical, but they're usually seen as this like checkbox that engineers need to check for compliance, and it becomes something that they're begrudgingly doing instead of something that they're excited about or that they feel like they're making a positive impact with. So the two biggest examples, I think, are one is called the GDPR, and that is it's based out of the EU. So it's a European law for all European countries, and it applies widely to the US too. And it forces a bunch of laws for ethics for any platform that caters to citizens of the EU, which basically forced all of Silicon Valley to change their privacy practices to help make it better for European citizens, and then eventually for American citizens, because they realized that it was kind of hypocritical to have it be better for certain people than others. And then eventually, like the rest of the world, they just kind of made their privacy practices better. So it's turned out well, and it's had a really positive impact, but a lot of engineers hate the GDPR because it just makes a lot of extra work for them. And so that's like a specific example. There's also this Association for Computing Machinery is called the ACM. And that's like one of the biggest organizations for all computer scientists. And they have their own conduct of ethics and their ethical guidelines that technically all engineers are supposed to follow. But I mean, like any ethical guidelines, they're suggestions and they're recommendations, but there's no legally binding contract between engineers and these ethical principles. And it's hard enough too, because who's going to come up with the perfect ethical principles that apply to everybody? Like, there's a Universal Declaration of Human Rights that the UN came up with, and people have problems with that too, because every community, every individual, depending on the time of day, every person might have a different ethical framework that they live by. And it's really hard to encapsulate that in like a global scale that everybody is okay with and happy with, that doesn't cause any harm. So there's a lot of tension, a lot of challenges, and there's a lot of people that are doing good work in this space, and it's going in a lot of positive directions, but I think there's still a lot of work to be done, especially in getting technologists into policy positions so that people who are making laws can actually speak this technological speak, and they can keep up with some of these tech companies to try to rein them in a little bit. Oh, you're muted, Kelsey.
Something you had just said was about the everyone having kind of that different ethical or moral code that they live by. And at NCWIT, we really advocate for the diversity and inclusion of all different people in computing careers. So I would say that would also translate to then the ethical considerations of what companies are turning out. Is this a job that companies are really looking for to fill? Or what is this a growing career? Is it limited right now? What does it look like in the job market?
So it's definitely a growing career. There's various types of positions on sort of this like gradient sliding scale, where some companies are just looking for people to say that they're ethicists so that they can have, you know, they can avoid PR scandals, and so that they can say, but we have ethicists, we have people who are thinking about this. And some companies are hiring to actually try to make positive change. And so I think there's like everything in between those two sides of the coin. There's also there's engineers that are being hired to think specifically about things like fairness and bias and discrimination and racism and sexism. So there's technical careers, there's also policy careers, and the people who are trying to make sure that the decisions that engineers are making aren't going to get them in legal trouble, but also for ethical reasons. And then there's also social scientists, people who are talking to real humans on the ground. I know it's crazy if for a tech company, talking to real humans doesn't always happen, but they're being hired to talk to the users of these apps and platforms to try to figure out what kind of harms are being caused and how to mitigate some of those harms too. So yes, it's a growing field. It's going to continue to grow. And it's the first time in the last few years, it's like the first time that I've seen big tech companies start to really hire a lot more social scientists and a lot more people in the humanities as opposed to just computer scientists. So I think that the prospects for jobs of all different kinds are really looking up.
Yeah, I think that's really great. And what you had talked about earlier is like asking how the different pieces of technology make people feel. And then something that we really like to, when we're counseling students, especially career counseling, is asking students what problem they would like to solve. And this seems like a wonderful job or career to start pointing students to if they're identifying these problems and they want to make an impact. So I've liked everything you had to share. One last question for you. You did sort of answer about how your brother encouraged you, and at NCWIT we talk about the encouragement gap, especially when it comes to people of color or females, how they're encouraged to go into STEAM careers, computing careers. What pieces of encouragement could you have used, or other encouragement that you did receive that would have pointed you even more into this direction?
Yeah, definitely. I think at the time I had a skewed view of computer science, and probably also because my brother was a stereotypical computer scientist. And at this time the field was even less diverse than it is now. And so I had this like vision and this image of what a computer scientist looked like. And because I didn't look like that, I didn't think that it was the career for me. And so what I would have loved at the time was for somebody to point out, like, for example, one of my idols in college became a woman named Kate Crawford, who has done amazing pioneering work on AI ethics, both on the policy side and the technical side and just all sides. And she founded an institute with another amazing woman, and the institute is called AI Now. And they were doing this work back when I was considering what kind of career I wanted to do. So if my brother had come up to me and said, hey, look, this woman named Kate, she looks like you. She does these things like you. She has the same interests as you. She's doing this amazing work and she's changing the world in a positive way. If I had seen that role model back then, I would have seen myself in her shoes, and I would have been way more likely to persevere and push through some of the hardships of getting a computer science degree, knowing that that was what waited on the other end. So I think that this, like, the perspective of being able to see yourself in this like amazing place where you see some of your idols and the people that you really look up to, maybe some of your heroes, that would have really helped me back then, especially being somebody who wasn't traditionally seen as a computer scientist at the time.
Yeah, so that aligns perfectly with what NCWIT and specifically Counselors for Computing, we talk about the intentionality of how we present these careers, making sure that we are inviting speakers and even for our career fairs, things like that, that look like our students. So that way they feel even more encouraged to go into these careers. I can't tell you how much we appreciate this presentation. I would like everyone to know that has attended, this recording will be available on our landing page in a little over a week, probably by the end of next week. And this is something that you'd be able to share with your students, maybe next semester, if you wanted to, as another way for your students to be able to see different people in these career fields have those role models. So thank you so much, Jess.
Thank you.
And so we would like to invite you all to our July web advising for Future Ready Careers. We're going to be talking to aerospace engineers, board of directors for a STEAM magazine, a very encouraging group of ladies that have been bringing these STEAM careers to the front lines of all of our students. You can register by visiting our landing page, and that's shared in the chat. And you can continue to receive updates from NCWIT C4C by filling out the link in the chat for updates. Look out for our survey in your email within the next few days to receive your $50 Amazon gift card if you were one of the first 150 people to register and attend. You also receive your resource kit. And we thank you again for your responses and for joining us, and we hope to see you next month. Bye.